Okay, so we're going to get started. I'll apologize in advance. I got sick over the weekend and managed to lose my voice, but it's kind of back. Kind of is the emphasis. I have my bottle of hand sanitizer, so I hope I don't get any of you sick. I probably got it from one of you anyway. Who was sick last? No, I'm kidding. it's such is life. So you know who you are. No. So we have to, as much as I would like to just say, why don't you work for the day, there's 2 weeks of class left, which means there's 4 actual days where I can sit here and impart all of my glorious, wonderful wisdom to you before you're done seeing me forever. No. And so I wanna talk, and you guys are just going to have to bear with me and my voice and how awful I sound. What we're going to concentrate on over the next couple lectures is you've done all this work, hopefully, to create this beautiful Rhino model that's in 3D. How do you go backwards and get good quality line drawings out of your model so that you can put them up on a presentation and not have to go back to AutoCAD and redraw all the floor plans and that sort of thing? To me, it seems like way too much work to go backwards and redraw everything over again because you've done all the work already and you've built it. So when I first started teaching the class, we emphasized V-Ray renderings, and we got 4 kind of pristine renderings: the interior night, the exterior night, the interior day, and the exterior day. So we got those 4. I have since added on to the final project that you need to have the plans, sections, elevation views as well. So that's part of the final. I'm expecting that as part of the final. My brain's foggy. I have to go back and double check. But I believe that I asked for 2 of the 3 views. So 1 elevation and 1 plan, 1 elevation and 1 section, 1 plan and 1 section. You pick which ones. So if one of them doesn't turn out, oh well. Right? Gives you some flexibility. We're going to start today with the elevations. I think the elevations are probably the easiest of the 3, but we'll work through all of the above so that you get the experience with all of them and you see me do it over and over again. So today we're going to do elevation views. On Wednesday we'll do plan views. Next Monday we'll do section views. And then Wednesday, if you guys are up for it, we'll do some Photoshop, make the last little splash effect or whatever. So then everything's due 2 weeks from today on Monday the 22nd. Class time is different that Monday. You guys start at 10:30 instead of at 11, and you only go until 12:30 here. So just like with 135, I'll bring donuts. And then I'll have those surveys for you to fill out so that you guys can tell me how much you like the class or how much you didn't like the class or what I should change or what have you. So, and those obviously do mean a lot to me, so I appreciate you guys spending the time to do that. So we're gonna talk through how to create an elevation today. The exercise handout is unbelievably brief because it refers you to this 10.8 tutorial. And I spent a lot of time on this one trying to go through each view, everything that I'm gonna do so that you can really see how it all comes together. I think it's a little bit complicated, and that's why I want to show you the process, but recognize that you can come back to this 10.8 and see exactly what I'm going to do today as well. So the first part of this whole thing is to figure out what? Really? Did somebody customize this without me knowing? What? Oh. This is going to destroy me today, if this is the case. Okay, hold on. Yeah, it's going to do this, isn't it? Okay, they killed my right click to orbit, and this is... Pause. This has also been how my day is going. Just, This is destroying me right now. Ah, bad mouse. There we go. Okay, sorry about that. So the first thing that I need to do is I need to establish the elevation view. And obviously, if I get myself into position on an elevation view, it looks like an elevation view, but it's really still a perspective view. So I have a couple options for how I go about really setting this up. The first thing is I can go to one of my previously established views. So I could look at my front, right, left, back view, and I could get to a particular view. So in this case, I picked front. The problem is that the front view is this is the ocean bowl, and it's blocking my view. I'm going to go ahead and just hide that object for right now so I can see my overall piece. I do want to see this in the front view. I want to make sure that I see it in its shaded mode for right now. And I'm going to customize it a little bit so that I see just the part of my building that I really want to see. So maybe it's about there or so. I get a little bit of the surrounding context. That feels pretty good. Now I'm going to go in and I'm going to save this view so I can return to it. We do want to confirm that my projection mode is set to parallel. If your projection mode is set to perspective, you'd end up seeing it's close, but see how that pool, for example, vanishes? We don't want to see that. This is a true elevation view, so we want to be in parallel. We'll zoom in again there, like that. I'm going to go ahead and save this view. So I'll click on the little triangle. I'll go to Set View, Named Views, and we're going to call this one Front Elevation. And I'll go ahead and say OK. Oh, remember, there shouldn't be any spaces. There we go. And I'll say OK. So the advantage here is, obviously, I can return to this view a little bit later on. So there's a few other pieces that are important when we start to establish this. The ultimate goal is to take this view and bring it into Illustrator, because we can scale it in Illustrator, and then we can do a little bit of collage work in Illustrator. So when I do this, I want to know exactly what the boundary of this view is. And in order to see that, I'm going to click on the little triangle next to Front Elevation, and I'm going to go to Set Camera, and then Show Camera. Which does nothing in this view, but in my other views, if I zoom out here, we will see a camera view. So because it's in parallel projection, the camera is really long versus the normal wide-angle triangle that we're used to seeing. So this camera here represents the view that I'm looking at right here. Now, I want to draw in a rectangle that represents this boundary, and I can do that using the points of this camera. So let me switch this into wireframe for just a second so we can see it. There's my target of my camera right there, and there's my outer bounds of the camera. I can create a rectangle. So I'll do a rectangle, and I'm going to do this one, 3 points. And I'm going to make sure that my snap is set to point, which it is. And I'm going to snap from there to right there to right there. And so this rectangle there, see how it fits exactly 1/4 of my overall view? Once I have this as 1/4, I'm going to scale this from this corner by 2, and it's going to fill the overall size. You can't actually see this rectangle because it's just barely there in this front elevation view. So what I've done is I've created a view that represents what I'm seeing in this view. And this will matter when we do the next piece, which is called Make 2D. And so far, you guys have never seen me do a Make 2D, but Rhino has this really cool thing built into it that I wish other software would do as well. And that is that any view that you establish in Rhino, you can create a live line drawing of that particular view. So I'm going to use it today for an elevation, but it would work for a perspective, for example. Any view that you have, you can create. And you'll see it in just a second as I create it. So the command for this is called make 2D. So a couple things. Before I do the make 2D, I would like to have some contours running up my surface so that I can represent the contour lines as part of my elevation view. So I'm going to do a contour command really quick. This just helps with the look. And I'm going to contour this surface here. So I'll type contour, my base point, kind of doesn't matter. There we go. And I want it to be going straight up in the Z direction, like that. And I'll do a contour distance, let's do 2 feet. There's going to be a lot of them. I probably should put them on their own layer, too. There we go. And so I'll do a contour with 2 feet. There they are, starting to show up nicely. Perfect. It has to finish up back in. There we go. So it finished. That's just going to help the overall look. So let me go back to my front elevation view. I'm going to go back to set view and make sure it is, in fact, the front elevation, so I didn't accidentally zoom in or zoom out or anything. And I'll make sure nothing's selected. And now I'm going to go ahead and type make 2D. Make 2D, and I'll press Enter. It's going to ask me to select objects to draw. I'm going to go ahead and say All. Makes it easy to select. And it selects all my objects. I really don't want to draw all of these little grass things, so I'll probably turn off the bunch grass because that's going to take too much. So the furniture is fine. I'll leave that. So I've selected objects to draw. Press Enter when done. I'll go ahead and press Enter. And then it brings up the Make 2D Drawing Options dialog box. So I want to do a drawing of the current view, which is correct. And then we come down to these options. So do I want to show tangent lines? I'm going to leave those unchecked for right now. Do I want to show hidden lines? I'm going to leave this checked for yes because I think it can enhance the view a little bit later on. So I'm going to leave that one checked. And do I want to maintain source layers or not? So this one's kind of important because it has to do with when it goes into Illustrator down the road, do we care whether we maintain layers or not? And so this has to do with do I want to differentiate the line thicknesses of, say, the windows versus the walls? If I have different layers for windows and walls, I can go through and select. The warning that I have here is that if you have hundreds of layers, you're suddenly going to end up with hundreds of layers in Illustrator, which, if you've worked in Illustrator at all, you know is really annoying. So for right now, I'm going to uncheck Maintain Source Layers, which is going to give me two layers, a visible layer and a hidden layer, and I'm just going to work with those. Okay, so that's unchecked. The visible lines are going to go on a layer that's under Make 2D called Visible Lines, and then there'll be another one for Make 2D Hidden Lines. So I get those two layers, and then I'll go ahead and say OK. Now this process can take a while. When I say OK, it could take a couple minutes to process. So we're going to let it do its thing. And when it's done, I'll show you the end result. OK, so that was a few minutes. I don't know how long it was, but it is a matter of just being patient. Now, what happens when we do the Make 2D is if we switch, you know, everything deselects in the front elevation, we don't see anything different. But if we switch over and we look in the top view, and we look for 0.00, and we zoom in, we now have a flat line drawing of the view that we just created. And so on the surface, it's like, well, wait a minute, why does that matter? Here, let me show you in perspective here. See how that's our flat line drawing now? So what does that matter? What matters is that this is now an exportable live line drawing that represents our elevation. If it's in perspective, it's even cooler because you actually have a perspective drawing that it created from your view as if you constructed it by hand as a perspective. So I'm going to work in the top view for right now, and I'm going to clean this up a little bit. So first off, if I take these lines, let me take this, oops, this one, they represent my viewport right there. I'm going to go ahead and trim, and I'm going to get rid of all of this other stuff because I don't need all of these other lines. There. And then I can go in and I can select all my Make2D except for that. And we'll get rid of that. That's all superfluous information. This now, right there, is a line drawing that is contained with a couple different sublayers. There's a visible set and a hidden set. And if I were to zoom in here, you could see that this is, in fact, my building elevation. The white lines represent the hidden lines, things that are behind in my drawing. The black lines are representing things that are in the foreground for me. So I'm going to clean a few things up. Number one, when you get into Illustrator, it's really annoying to have white as your layer color because it's really hard to select them. So I'm going to change these layer colors to be anything but white. So we'll go through and I'm just going to pick. Colors for these. And you'll see why this is relevant a little bit later on. Okay, so that's fine. It doesn't look particularly attractive right now, but we're not going to worry about it. I'm going to go ahead and select this object like that, and I'm going to go to File and then Export Selected. And I'm doing this from the top view. And I'm going to put this on my flash drive in today's folder. This is spring of 2017. And we'll call this elevation, front elevation. Spring of 2017. Now, under Save As Type, I'm going to choose to make it an Adobe Illustrator file. So AI. When I do that, and I go ahead and click Save, it's going to prompt me with this AI Export Options dialog box. This is where you can actually scale your drawing. So I want this to be at quarter scale. So 48 inches is going to be 1 inch. That's quarter inch equals a foot, essentially. So once I'm done, I'll go ahead and say OK. And I've now exported that. If I open up Adobe Illustrator, and then go to File and Open, and I go find that file. It is front elevation, and I click open. If I press control minus, there it is. Unfortunately, it didn't quite put it where I wanted it to be, so I have to make some adjustments. So first off, I'm going to select all these lines, and I'm just going to move them over to be closer to where my drawing artboard is. So we'll say something like that. Now if I zoom in, we can see my lines, and we can see my artboard. I'm going to go ahead and edit the artboard, which looks like the crop symbol in Photoshop. It's right there. If I click on that, it lets me edit the paper size. So now I'm going to edit this paper size to match up with the drawing that I created. So we'll do it like that. When I'm done, I'll hit Enter. Oops, never mind. I won't hit Enter. I'll just go back to the black arrow. And if we Control 0 now, we can see that I have a line drawing that represents my building. Okay, it doesn't look like too much yet because I haven't edited my layers. Let me come over and I'm going to look at my layers here. I have two different sets of lines. One is visible and one is hidden. And if I had said maintain source layers, I'd have a whole bunch of layers separate. So if you feel comfortable and you want to give it a shot, maintaining source layers and then adjusting line weights based on different content, you can do that. This is the simple way. So first thing that I'm going to do is I'm going to turn off all the hidden lines, and I'm going to work with just the visible lines, just these green ones. So with the visible lines, I want to select all of them. So I'll click on right there next to my layer. I'll click on that little square. It selects all the lines. I could also press Control A. And I'm going to change the color. So let's look here at the stroke color. We're going to change that stroke color to be black. And I'll say OK. Now all of those lines are black. Next thing I'm going to change is the stroke width. So I'll go to the stroke menu. If you're not seeing the whole window here, you'll have to click the little flyout to say show options, and that'll let you see everything. And I'm going to set my thickness at maybe 0.25, like that. Now if I click off, we can see a pretty nice line drawing. Let me control A and let me set these at 0.5 instead. There you go. For you guys to see them, I might go up a little bit. Let's try 1. Now you can see it a little bit better. So essentially what Rhino did for me is it created a line drawing. And this is now an elevation view of my building. Now I'd like to tweak a few things. One, all of these lines that represent the contours, those don't need to be nearly as dark. So if I were to select all of those, we could change them to be maybe 0.25 point, because I don't need those to be quite as strong. So it'll take me a little bit of time to select all of them. Let's take those, and let's change them to be 0.25. Looks like I missed a few, so this one needs to change. So there's always some cleanup that needs to be done. .25 is that one. .25. Oops, one more. .25. Okay, so then this one that represents the ground here, these should probably be a little bit thicker. So let's take those ground lines, take that, and let's make those, I don't know, maybe 1.5. They're a little bit thicker. I'll get rid of that piece, and I'll get rid of that piece. Likewise, this was a seamless wall, so we can get rid of that. That's supposed to be seamless, we can get rid of that. So is that. That can go away. That shouldn't be there anymore. That shouldn't be there anymore. So you see, I have to go through and I have to make some adjustments. Let me zoom in here a little bit. That shouldn't be there. Shouldn't be there. This line and this line should match. And I'll use my eyedropper tool if I can find it. Why am I not seeing it? There it is. Should match that. Likewise, this and those two should match that. So there's always some cleanup to do. Like this line here really needs to come up to meet that point. So there's always a little bit of tweaking that needs to happen. So now that I have the visible lines showing, and I'm happy with those, now it's time to look at the hidden lines. So let me go to the hidden lines, and I'll turn everything else off. So Rhino also produces the hidden lines, the lines that we're not seeing, some of which are relevant and some of which are not. If I select all of them, and I change their color, instead of being black, let's pick kind of a medium gray, something like that. Let me make the line weight on them at least 0.25. I might do a little bit smaller. But down here, I'm going to turn on dashed line. And I'm going to do maybe a 1 point by 1 point dashed line. And so if we look at these, and I zoom in here a little bit, see how they're all little dashed lines? Maybe the 1 point isn't quite enough. Maybe it's a 4 point. And a 4 point. Oh, sorry, I have to select them all first. You kind of have to decide what looks right for you. So maybe it's like that. The advantage here of having all those dashed lines is now when I turn them on in context of the visible lines, I get a bunch of extra underlaid information. If I zoom in here a little bit, you can see it. right? Other information that's below. It adds depth to this drawing. So by itself, just doing this and then selectively going through, for example, I could make the line that goes around my building, I could make that a little bit thicker. That would make those lines stand out a little bit more. So there's little things that I could do to make it a little bit better. But just doing that gives me a nice high quality line drawing of my project. And I'll tweak this a little bit more. But I can take this a step further because I still have this view set up in the world of Rhino. So the first thing that I can do is I can come back to this front elevation view and I can render out the full color version with lights and all of that sort of thing. So if I went into my V-Ray options and I went to my output, looks like I have a decent output already set up here. I do want to make sure that I get this exact view aspect ratio because this front elevation view is my view. I'll get it, I'll lock it, and then I'll set this to a particular size. Let's do something like that. And then let's go ahead. I forget whether this is going to be a day or a night render. I don't remember. Give me a second. So apparently this one's the night render. And I can then go ahead and I can do a rendering with all the lights and everything that I've created as part of this, and I'll show you how that can overlay. And then I'm going to go through a clay rendering. So bear with me, I have to let this finish rendering, and that'll show you how to drop it in. Okay, so there you go. There's the night the night rendering of my scene. I know you guys can't see that much. And I really should have done a day because it would have shown up better long term. But I'm going to go ahead and save all my channels. So I'll click the multiple disk icon. And then we're going to go back to, my flash drive for today's folder. We're going to drop it in here. And we'll call this night render. And this was the front elevation. And I'll go ahead and click Save, which saves all my channels as part of it. Now, the advantage here is that if I go back to Illustrator and I go to File, let me put a new layer here. And I'm going to call this Background Image. If I can type. With that selected, I'll go to File and then Place. And I can then drop in the why am I not saying spring of 2017? How convenient. Why did it not save those? Hold on a second. I put them in the wrong folder. My mistake. They're supposed to go in here. Elevation. Night render. There we go. Save. Okay. There they are. I'm going to use my base view here. I'll click place. And you'll see that my image aspect matches up with my document size. So all I have to do is adjust the size to match up from one corner to the other corner like that. And my building is going to match up with my drawing. So it's probably a little hard for you guys to see. And one of my other problems is all of my lines were black. So let me take my visible lines here and let me change those from black to white. Now you can probably see it a little bit better. And I can overlay the line drawing that I was working on top of the rendering. So I've combined the line drawing and the materials rendering, which sometimes people want to do. The other option for something like this, instead of doing it as a line drawing, or instead of doing it as this kind of material photorealistic rendering drawing hybrid, is that we can export and do a render that is a clay render. And before you do a clay render, I always recommend making a save as, just in case something gets messed up. So I'll go to File and then Save As. And I'm going to call this one Master Site Front Elevation Clay. I'll click Save. So what a clay rendering is it is a rendering that takes away all the materials but renders the shadows for us. So if I go to my resources under V-Ray and I go to Quick Rendering Setups, we've done the day scenes, we've done the night scenes, we've done the sunsets, and if you come down here a little bit further, we get clay rendering. And so this is an example of a clay rendering. It's the shadows by themselves, essentially. And so I have set up for you an easy VisOp file to load. So you're going to right click and save this. So I'll save the link as, and I tend to keep it on my flash drive in my resources folder in V-Ray, HDRI, and I'll just put it here as the clay render. I'll go back to this scene. I'm going to go to my V-Ray options, make sure some drawer is open, it doesn't matter which one, and I'm going to load the clay render. If I hadn't saved as, I would make sure I save my VisOp file so that I could go back to the other VisOp. But since I did a save as, I'm not going to worry about it. Let me go into resources, V-Ray, HDRI, there it is, there's the clay render, and I'll go ahead and say open. And when I do that, all my settings change. The only tricky part here is the sun. And so in my case, I didn't have a sun on because it was a night scene, so I'm not going to worry about it. But if you had a sun on, you'd want to turn it off. Let's go ahead and do a render and check. Let me go to V-Ray options, let me go to output. I'm going to unlock, get my view aspect so it matches. I'm going to lock, and I'm going to do a really small one to make sure that it's looking the way I want it to. This render should happen very, very quickly because we've gotten rid of a lot of the materials. So in this case, it's a little bit too dark for me. So let me go back to my options here. Let me go back and adjust my camera. It's at 100, let's try 25. A little bit lighter, maybe even a little bit less. Let's go a little bit more here. 10. There you go. Something like that'll work out just fine. Now let me up my size. So I'll go to my V-Ray options again. And under my viewport here, And then we'll go ahead and render it out in larger size. And so the nice thing is clay renders happen pretty quick. So if you wanted to set this for a particular time of day, obviously you could to get certain shadows. That would be up to you. This is not set for a particular time of day, but it does give some relief to this. Okay, so that's done, but all it's showing me is essentially the shadows. It's as if it were a solid clay object with some shadows on it. So I'm going to save all the channels for this one. Same folder here. This is going to be my front. Clay render. I'll click save. Saves all the channels. Now I'll go back to my Illustrator file here. I'm going to turn off the background image. I'm going to make all of my lines black again. So we can see them. There they are. I'll create a new layer. Put it below my lines called clay render. There we go. And now let me go control minus to zoom out a little bit. And I'll go to file and then place. And I'm going to drop in that front elevation clay render this time. There it is. Once again, I have to do some resizing of it. Oops. I'll hold down Shift as I make it bigger. It'll snap for me nicely. And now you can see on this that it provides just a little bit of shadow relief as part of my drawing. And this really can enhance your overall view of a particular scene because it has that little bit of rendered shadow to it. Right? So this is subtle. This is very much a line drawing. The other one with the photo background is more of a rendering hybrid. But I think something like this with a little bit of shadow behind really turns out to be a nice quality drawing that you could put on a presentation board and have good results. Sometimes people like to put a little bit of texture behind a particular scene, whether it's in the sky or on the ground. And you could see in the handout that I gave you here, I did the sky in that particular one. All I did was I followed, if we go back into the tutorials here, if we go into Illustrator, right down in here, 310 for background texture, it talks about how do you drop a background texture onto a particular file and have it show up. We could do the same thing on this file. If it was selected, I can go to my opacity. I'm going to click on Make Mask, which allows me to put a texture right here. Let me go to File and then Place, and I'll drop in some kind of a grunge texture. And you guys know I'm a big fan of the grunge textures. Go into Resources, there's my grunge textures, and we'll drop something in behind. Let me make it a little bit bigger. Something like that. And let me see if I invert it. No, that's the right look. It's hard for you guys to even really see it on the projector. I'll see if I can zoom in and show you. Yeah, there you go. It has just a little bit of paper quality. It's like wrinkled paper behind. It's subtle, but it makes it not quite as stark. That's probably not the best clipping mask to put in. Let's see if I can find one that's a little bit better here. Do this one and see if it shows up. Can you guys see that any better? No, it's amazing how much I can see it on my screen and you guys really can't. Hold on. There you go, you guys can see that one. Let me go ahead and rotate this one. Make it a little bit bigger. Something like that. It just roughens up the texture of it a little bit. And again, it looks better on my version than it does on yours. And you could decide maybe only the hillside is that and the building is back white. I don't know, you have to kind of sort through what feels right in your particular instance. Okay, so this was kind of the first trial run of creating a line drawing. As is the case at this point in the semester, you guys know what your time is best used for. Remember that the assignment, the final, does require a line drawing or two. So now would be a good time to try it out. If you feel like you still need modeling time, work on modeling. Make sure you do post something for today's exercise. Because if you don't post anything, I get you credit for it. I will try to have updated grade sheets next week so that you guys know where you currently stand as we go into the end. Recognize you're running out of time. And so it's time to start wrapping up, time to get these line drawings out. If you've modeled your building, making a line drawing of it's really easy. And my guess is those of you that are in 220 and 221, this is the kind of thing you're going to be doing out of your Rhino models, assuming you have a Rhino model to begin with. Okay? So it should overlap. I think this is probably one of the most important things you can learn in the world of Rhino is how to create these drawings, because then you can harness the fact that you built a good quality 3D model and get nice line drawings out of it. Okay? Any questions?